והנה, and behold, הגם שאין נביא רשאי לחדש דבר. So we said yesterday that the Nevi'im brought Atzilus down into Bria, Yetzirah, and Nesiyah, emanation down into the three lower worlds, from a state of there being no separate consciousness from Hashem to a state like where we are, where we have a separate consciousness. So even though a Navi is not allowed, a prophet is not allowed to innovate anything, he's not allowed to do something new that wasn't done in the Torah this name doesn't exist. Tzva'ot. Ach ein ze chidush v'tosefet al Torat Moshe Rabbeinu alav ha-shalom. But this is not considered to be an addition. Why? Rak hamshachat ha-Torah b'li tosefet b'geron me'atzilut l'briyah. So we talked about this a little bit yesterday. We said the Rebbe's famous statement that you bring the Torah to the, you bring the Jews to Torah, you don't bring the Torah to Jews. Meaning, what he meant was that you don't change the Torah to accommodate people. And here's the same thing. There's nothing being changed. It's the still the same Torah. It's just being brought down without addition or subtraction into the world of creation. V'zeu inyan shen tzvakot sheniskar b'nevi'im. Ki tzvaot hu leshon chayolot. And this is what the prophets meant when they turned to a holy name, because it means armies. V'hem gdudei neshamot u'malachim debriyah sheren mispar l'gduda v'hem nivrim u'mchudashim ma'ayin l'yesh mamash. And what it's referring to, it's connecting the armies. Which armies? The souls and the angels and these innumerable spiritual entities that exist with a separate consciousness in the world of creation, it's connecting them back to Or Ein Sof, back to the light of the infinite, and back to the Atzilus, back to the world of emanation. And what's special about them are the Hem Nivreim Umchodashim Ma'ayin LeYesh Mamash. It's not that they chose to be this way. This is how Hashem made them. They were created this way. Ve'enan elokut klal kmo atzilut shu b'chinat elokut mamash. And unlike the state of entities in the world of emanation, they're not considered to be divine. Ve'af al pichon hanevi'im imshichu shehitlabesh bahem or ein sof baruch hu. And that's a tremendous bringing down. That even in a creation was created this way by Hashem, they have a separate consciousness and so on. Even within these creations, the light of the infinite can shine. Betachlita yichud, with a complete unification, kmo shenitlabesh bekelim de'atzilut, exactly in the same way, well, not in the same way, but in the same, with the same effect that existed in the vessels of the world of emanation. That there, adi'u ve'gomo yichad, until even the person and his vessels, meaning the infinite light in the soul and the vessels, meaning the body, become mamish one. Until the infinite light can be called armies, that the infinite light became into the many. And again, armies in Hebrew, it doesn't mean what it means in English. And there's no good translation. I guess hosts is a better translation, but I'm not sure. But armies doesn't mean that armies always comes from military, from some kind of might. That's not the meaning. The meaning is separation. The meaning is that everything has its own character. Really, tzvaot means different characters. That's really what it means. It comes from the word tzivon, with an ayin. And the ayin and the aleph, which they can be switched many times. So it really comes from the word tzeva, which is color. So tzvaot just means there's many, many, many different variations.
Groups? Yeah. Groups?
No? No, it's just a myriad of variations.
Masses.
But masses, again, sounds like they're colorless. The whole point here is that each one is something different. Mamash kinyan iu v'gomo yichad shevatzilut shu atzmo hu ade'ah. And this is exactly what it says about the world of emanation, that he and his vessels are one, which in emanation means that the vessel in emanation is like the Deya. Deya is...
emanations, you mean Atzilus?
Atzilus, yeah. In Atzilus, the Deya, meaning the... Here we say, Keshem Shepartzufeim Shonim Deoteim Shonot. And from creation and on, we say that the fact that we have different faces indicates, meaning our form, indicates our function. That we have different missions, different ideas, a different soul, basically. In emanation, it's not that way. There's no difference, as it were, between... You couldn't tell one thing from the other. It would all seem the same to you. The difference wouldn't come from looking at something. The difference would come from how that something acted, what it represented. And sort of like in emanation, there's a general feeling, because everything is so included in God, it's so godly everything, that it's very hard to differentiate. It's like being shined with a very bright light and you can't see the details. Everything just looks to you, you see silhouettes, as it were. And that's one of the big differences between emanation, between Atzilus and the three lower worlds. How you doing? But the three lower worlds, what you see is more the form and you less see the function. In Atzilus, it's reversed. What you see is mostly the function. You see the movement, as it were. Like, imagine, you're looking at people with a bright light behind them. Mm-hmm. So what you see is, you see the form. They're different, they are different, but you can't see them. You can't tell that they're wearing different clothes or have a different face or whatever, because the bright light is just masking that. It's not letting you see it. But what you do see is that you see what they're doing. You see their function. You see this guy's lifting his arm, this guy's doing this. You see the function. You follow what I'm saying? In creation, formation, and action, it's exactly the opposite. That what I see about you is I see how you're different externally, your form. I don't see that your function is different. In fact, that's where the idea of masses comes from. It's like that everybody's the same. It's not true. That's why you know, there's dictators and terrible things in the world. People, like, they're not individuals. You treat people like they're all just the same. It's just a mass of people. They're just a number. But so that's in creation. That's why it's so hard for us to see the godliness in a person, because we see the form, we don't see the function. But what the Nevi'im did was they brought that function down, that they could be, that the creatures, the entities in creation, formation, and action, the three lower worlds, in spite of the separate consciousness from God, could be a vehicle for God's infinite light. And so that's a tremendous, tremendous thing. So in what he's saying here is, in Atzilus, the function and the Shem are one thing. The Deya and the Shem, that's what he calls the vessel. He calls the vessel here the Deya, the character, call it, of the entity there. So in Atzilus, the Chochmah and the Bina and the Da'at, what you feel is that they're just godly. It's very hard to tell them apart, but you feel that they do different functions that are godly. Here below, you see that, first of all, that they're separate, but you don't understand what they're doing. So the Nevi'im turned it into such a way that even though you're down here, you would be able, there would be able to be examples, exemplars, of individuals who are in creation and who are so full of infinite light that you're astounded by it.
What did the Nevi'im do to do that?
That's the name Tzvakot. For us, it sounds like it's something linguistic. Yeah, they just changed something. But we talked a lot about this, that the ability to innovate language, especially in Hebrew, that's what prophecy is about. And prophecy is saying that if I can say something, I'll say it another way. What did the Arizal innovate? So if you're really careful about learning him, you'll see that he didn't innovate anything. He didn't say anything new. No, it's all written in the Zohar. But he found the language, he found a way to describe these things. He built a language, he really built a language that suddenly changed everything. It changed your whole perspective, everything that you saw, and so on. The language changes the way that that you perceive things. It's all about language. That's why I keep telling people, if you don't write, or if you don't express yourself in some way, so you're missing out on a lot of what you could be. Meaning, you develop through writing. You become who you are through writing, through language. So in their time, there wasn't writing, there was just language. There was very little writing. Although that's why the Nevi'im all wrote, and Moshe Rabbeinu wrote, and they understood that even though this is a very difficult task, it was very difficult back then, it was still well worth it. But in our time, there's no excuse. I mean, everybody has to write something every day. Mamash has to write. You just write 10 lines, but you got to write something. And I keep telling you in my other classes, after I can't compare something that I heard taught to something that I heard taught and then I wrote it. It's like two complete different levels of understanding, not to mention that I also understand things that I could never understand when I just listen. But when I write it afterwards and I begin to work it through, the level of comprehension is just completely different. It's integrated, it becomes you. Whereas when you hear something, so you know, it comes in from here, goes out from there. It's a little bit trickles in. But when you write it, it becomes you. You become it. When you create language, it's even more powerful. So that's what they did. They created a word. It sounds trivial, but it's not just any word. It's the word that is a new name for Hashem. And it that you can call Hashem, I mean, imagine that somebody would say, okay, imagine, that iPhone is a holy name. Imagine something ridiculous like that. So first of all, everybody would go crazy. What are you talking about? And then he'd prove it to you. No, look, really, there's no more bad content. Imagine there was no negative content. Would you or would you not recognize this as something godly? There's no negative content at all. It's only used to bring Torah to the different places. What would you say? Of course you'd say. What did they do? They just created a... So even in the word Tzvakot, Baruch Hashem, nothing negative attached to it. But there are people who understand that Tzvakot is something, it's so profane. What are you talking about? It's just the hosts, it's just the, like you said before, masses, it's just people. And this you're calling a holy name of God. What's going on? It's profane. It's not... So they said, no. This, the fact that there is a multitude of people with different character traits and so on and so forth, that is an expression of godliness. That's how Hashem is expressing himself in this generation. And the moment that you can give these things the name of God, meaning this community, conglomerate, whatever you want to call it, and you can give it the name of God, you've done something tremendous to change the way that they see themselves. So they say that by doing that, by naming the hosts, calling them by God's name, what they did was they allowed each individual to become a vehicle for God's infinite nature. That's an amazing thing. I mean, imagine somebody would, I mean, say it another way, the Rebbe tried, took the word shaliach, and he said, in shaliach plus 10 kochos ha-nefesh, the 10 powers of the soul, that's Mashiach. That's as close as the Rebbe came to giving something a name of God. Because he understood that people would understand that if, in my world, Mashiach is very serious. Mashiach is almost like a name of God, almost. It's not a name of God, but it's like as close as you can come. And so if I tell you that a shaliach, you're like the Mashiach, you just have to add something. So what am I telling you? I'm telling you can be a vehicle for a Mashiach. It's an incredible thing. Every shaliach has that in his head in some way. And that changes the way that they act. It's only language, it's just a little gematria, it's not like anything serious. And like, you gotta look at the impact that it has. If you take it seriously, language changes you. That's what they did. They created a word. And they called that word on the multitudes of the Jewish people. כך מתייחד בכלים דביעה עד שהוא עצמו הוא הצבאות. So he himself, Hashem himself, becomes the multitudes. ולא שהם נפרדים בפני עצמם, רק שבטלים עליו. אלא שמתייחד עם אין ממש. It's not that they remain separate, but rather that it gave them the power to nullify themselves before him, and then he becomes one with them entirely. וכמשל ייחוד וחיבור הנשמה עם הגוף. It's not their creations. They have a separate consciousness. They didn't take that away. They just gave the power of nullification. And the same thing is with the neshama, the soul and the body. שגם שהגוף הוא הכלי והעיקר היא הנשמה. אם כל זה מתאחדת עם הגוף שנקרא אדם הנשמה שבגוף ואין הגוף שם בפני עצמו. So you see the same thing, that when it comes to the person, like we see that in the end, we don't though today there's a real problem There's no more room. You can't bury everybody. They didn't, you know that they didn't used to bury people.
When?
In the time of the Tanakh and the time of the Gemara, what did they do? Until, it's until about, I think the year 300 or 400, maybe even a little bit later. I'm not sure when it stopped. But
caves.
the practice all the years was that you leave the body in a cave for a year, and by that time it's picked clean. There's only bones left. And the bones they would put together with other bones in a family burial spot. It was like a hole in the wall. And the bones were not separate. Like when you go down into Ma'arat HaMachpelah, you see this, that a lot of people wanted to be buried in Ma'arat HaMachpelah. It was a very popular spot. So it used to be that there were two shivas. Really, one shiva was 7 days, and the other one was 1 day. And the first one was just after the body was placed in the cave. And then for 7 days they had a shiva. And then a year later, it's called Yom Likut HaTzamot. So when the body was clean, was picked dry, and there was only bones left, so the day that they gathered the bones and put them in the pot in the general burial spot, so that was called Yom Likut HaTzamot, and they sat again for 1 day. That used to be the practice. So there was no body left, and nowhere did it say the person's name even. There was no place that you went to. You just went. That's what it means. That's exactly what it means, because the body is not the ikar. We're not.
So about the tzaddikim who didn't decompose.
They had a separate cave. Obviously, people wanted to be buried next to them, so they put them in a. Let's say there was such a thing. So they put him in a hole in the wall, and remained there. And everybody else went next to them because they were bones. Let's say there was such a thing. I don't know if there was such a thing. They didn't compose for a long time, but it's not that they never decomposed. It's not.
No, there's all the stories about tzaddikim.
Yeah, I know for a while, but not forever.
The story when the Nazis dug up the normally melech.
Sadly, but not forever. Yeah. And there you're talking about that we don't let it decompose. By the way. We don't let it decompose.
When they move the Rebbe Rashab?
We don't let the bodies decompose. You should know this. In the way that we bury, the body decomposes over 100 years. They're in bad state after 20 years. You don't want to look at them. And that's the difference. That here were people that 200 years later were in pretty good shape. But eventually the body decomposes. It just takes a long, long, long time. Especially in Chutz Haaretz, you put it into a casket. In Eretz Yisrael, it's quicker, but it's still much, much, much longer because something that's not in open air takes a long time to decompose. That's just how it is. So a year was enough. We don't know. Probably they chose certain caves for their qualities. There was a certain cave that you put the body in where it decomposed quickly, that there was fresh air that was coming in. And anyway, so. The body is not the main thing. That's how we know. Now, in this world, the way it is now. In the future, the body will be the main thing. The neshama will receive from the body. The roles will switch. But right now, the body is something passing. And the neshama is the main thing. And yet, the neshama completely connects with the body. The soul completely integrates into the body. It doesn't say because the body is separate from godliness, and so on, and I'm not, so I'm not going to completely integrate into it. It completely integrates. Uchaden kamtza deluf shei mine uvei. And we, thanks to what the Nevi'im did, what the prophets did with this, we have a state which we call that a person can reach where his body and his soul are one thing. That the garment expresses the soul. The garment being the body. And that's what we mean by a person who's holy. That the light of the infinite shines not just in the neshama, not just in the soul, but in the body itself, through the body itself. In the same way that a person who has wisdom, you call the whole person wise. The wisdom was out there somewhere, and then he started learning it. It entered into his mind. But because it entered into his mind and he became one with it, with his wisdom, he integrated it into him fully, so you say the whole person is wise. Even though you're talking theoretically only about the wisdom that he learned. And you're not talking about the body, and yet that's how it works. וכשקנה חוכמה, נקרא חכם על שם החוכמה, שהוא שם התואר. ככה דרך משל למעלה. אם היות הכלים דביעה עם מהות בפני עצמם, מבחינת נשמות ומלאכים נבראים, רק שבטילים אליו יתברך, אך עם כל זה, על ידי שהמשיכו הנביאים להיות גילוי אור אינסוף, ברוכו בהם על דרך ייחודו והצילות, אז נקרא הוא יתברך, הווי הצבקות, שהוא שם התואר, שהוא יתברך, הוא אחד עם הצבקות הנעל ואינן נפרדים. So it says the same thing happened here, that the name of God that is now named on these hosts, and these multitudes of people and angels that have a separate consciousness from divinity, it's one with the person, it's one with the angel. And it's called Havaya Tzvakot. The name Havaya becomes permanent Sefirot. How do we know this? Very simply. Because what was the situation in the world of, before the world of rectification, before the world of Tikkun, before Hashem started building the vessels back up into a world after they shattered? In the world of chaos, Netzach and Hod were one Sfira, entirely. They weren't two. And then when everything shattered, Hashem built it up again, He built it so that there would be two. He took the one, and he got two for the same price. So what that all means, there's a lot to be said about that, but it's
so what the passing. What were the ten in...
That was...
Oh, that was, so you had that
and that was a separate Sfira. And Netzach and Hod are not. It's a very important piece.
So you had Dat together and Keser.
No, they were separate. It was Keter, Chochmah, Binah, Dat.
Okay.
That's what you meant.
Right.
Saying it more clearly. ולכן שם הוויה מצטרף לשם צבקות, כי שם הוויה הוא באצילות. So the הוויה we're saying here is אצילות. It's the light of the infinite. והוא המשכת אור אינסוף בכלים באצילות. And it's what brings down the infinite light into the vessels of אצילות. This was said about all the names. ואם כן, כדי שיתמשך אור אינסוף בביאו על ידי שם הוויה בתחילה, וזהו הוויה צבקות. And for them to be, for the light of the infinite to come down into creation, formation and action, into the three lower worlds, so הוויה brings it down into צבקות. But what does this also mean? That in Netzach and Hod, in Atzilus, didn't have a separate name, as it were.
So maybe that's why we keep our feet together in Shemona Esrei.
Okay, in Atzilus, there's no separation.
Well, no,
they're keeping them straight. There's a little mistake in this, a little bit. But you're right. The mistake is that when it says you have to be that the malachim have. What do they have? They have one foot. Okay? Uh-huh. That's not what it says. Is raglehem regel yeshara. It says raglehem. You can't know. You can't know. What are we saying? Are you saying they have many feet? They have feet? Or are you saying they have a foot? Which one? You can't know in Hebrew.
Okay, many angels have one foot. Or
you can't know. Right. You know that they're separate, but you don't know if they have two or one. If I say raglam, then I'm saying they all have one. Mm-hmm. And elokam, we only have one foot. But when we say Elokeichem, it means each one of us separately has one God. But you can't know. You can't say Elokeichem. There's no way to pluralize that you don't know. So same thing with Raglehem Regel Yeshara. You can't know if they each have 2 feet or they have 1 foot. When it says Regel Yeshara, so it sounds more like they have one. But really what the pshat of the pasuk is, that they have a straight foot, meaning that they can't bend. They don't have a kneecap. That's the main thing. But what you just said is beautiful, because the continuation of the pasuk still insinuates, it implies that they have one foot.
So it's a return to the unification.
So that's they, because there we're talking, I guess, about angels in the world of Atzilus, and there they have only Netzach and Hod as one entity. But in the Zohar, that's how it's written. Netzach v'hod, and him, the language in the Zohar is. What's the language? I forgot. Palga gufa, half a body. So Zwei, by the way, Netzach and Hod, they correspond to many things. They correspond to the two legs.
The kidneys.
The kidneys. They're also to the testicles. But the most interesting one is that they correspond to the loins. And in Hebrew, the word for loins is plural, but you can't say it in one. You can't say it in the singular. The singular is I think a modern term, moten. In the Tanakh, it's only mutnai. But the one that certainly there's no singular for is the kidneys. In Hebrew, in the Tanakh, you can only say klayot. There's no kilia. They only come together. It's two that are one, really.
Well, they do say kilia.
It's modern
it's
Hebrew.
Modern Hebrew. Because they want to refer to one. So they invented a singular form. But in Tanakh, it never shows up in the singular form. It showed up in the singular form, really, they took it from Aramaic. Because in Aramaic, there's kulia. And kulia means a single kidney. But in Hebrew, there was no such thing. So that's an interesting thing in and of itself. That needs a lot of... But what it's saying is that the most change occurred in Netzach and Hod, more than anywhere else. And that's related to David, Chasdei David and Neimanim is Netzach and Hod. And most importantly, probably, that the main thing that we learn over the centuries is how to strengthen our Netzach and Hod, more than any of the other sefilot. Okay, so let's move in here and try to continue tomorrow. We don't have much left, and then we have a short one.
So